A very good afternoon and welcome to the seventh presentation, and today by Professor Christina Schuss, and she's research professor for philosophical anthropology and ethics at the Institute for the History of Medicine and Science Studies, University of Lübeck, and also affiliated to the University of Lüneburg in Germany. And Christina's areas of interest devoted to anthropology, ethics, epistemology, philosophy of time, very interesting from an aging perspective, and political philosophy. And she will share with us today a talk on bodily and social vulnerability, a phenomenological perspective on the practices of care. And you know the structure, so Christina will present for about 45, 50 minutes, and then we've got a question and answering session, and that will be led by Frans Vosman from the University of Humanistic Studies at Utrecht. Christina, most welcome.
Thank you, Jacob, for your warm welcome. Thank you to the Frans Vosman and Andres Barth, who have created this series, and I'm very honored to be here. Yes, indeed, I will talk about vulnerability. And before I really begin, I want to ask you a question. What is worse, to be betrayed by a friend or by a stranger? And if you answer, oh, it's a friend, of course, then later on, we will see what we make out of that. So this kind of guiding question will be resolved, perhaps, and discussed in the end. Vulnerability, as you know, we have the Latin vulnus in there, comes from the Latin. And basically, it is a notion which had been somewhat neglected in the history of philosophy, and with very good reasons. And before we come to the real part of this lecture, I have to ask what actually can be injured, what can be hurt. And if you believe in the Platonic ideas or Platonic philosophy, and if you share the division between soul and body, that is, between a soul which is inhabited in prison in the body, then you cannot talk about vulnerability, actually, because vulnerability refers to the body, to a lived body. And the same, if you believe in the Cartesian dualism, in the difference between res extensa and res cognitans, then you must say animals who have no soul cannot feel pain. So basically, these approaches in the history of philosophy cannot address vulnerability. If you address vulnerability, you have to talk about living beings. You have to talk about beings which can be injured and hurt. And you must talk about the living body. And this separation will not be possible. So therefore, the first point which should be made is that the human condition must be thought devoid of any dualism. The human condition is natality, mortality, of course, but it's also being bodily embedded, being linguistic, being able to age, being vulnerable. So this is one of the prerequisites we have to see, actually. Secondly, vulnerability has a, what is the other side, actually? What is the verb to vulnerability? What can be injured or hurt? So first of all, you have rights, but rights don't feel pain, yet rights can be harmed, can be violated. Secondly, you have things, physical things, you do damage to them. Well, you must not do it, but you can do damage to them. But you cannot hurt them. And the soul, you can perhaps heard, depends on which construction or what philosophical approach. So therefore, I would think as an ontological basis, only living beings can be hurt, can be harmed, or can be injured in this very sense, but of course harmed can be also relations and rules. Now, I will talk about this paradox, which I have included in this very first question to you. It seems to me to engage oneself in society or in relation, also to give birth to children, to trust your friend, to help or to act for people in need, injustice or bad situations, to politically fight for justice or to oppose dictatorship, all these actions might increase your vulnerability. They are dangerous. Yet, at the same time, you might get stronger, more secure, better off in life. The courage for vulnerability means to reach out in and for relations for a better world. There is, I think, the Italian philosopher Adriana Cavarero has nicely phrased this two poles of vulnerability. Two poles of vulnerability is being open for injury and harm, yet perhaps being strong and caring and cared for. She says, what is revealed is the two poles of the essential alternative inscribed in the condition of vulnerability, wounding and caring. And speaking about these two poles, I have to introduce you to the philosopher Emmanuel Levinas. For him, in the openness of the vulnerability of the other lies, as he would say, the silent cry, an ethical imperative of you shall not kill. The source of the subjectivation of the subject as being responsible for the other is formed and through our subjection to the other. The eye, from head to toe, up to the bone marrow, is vulnerability. The vulnerability is which every being in its natural pride would be ashamed to confess, the capability to be beaten, to get a slap around the face. That means the bodily dimension is the condition of an ethics of vulnerability, which is experience and sensitivity, which is positive, and pain, which is negative, that throws the I out of its position and brings the human out of the egocentric perspective. Thus, we might say both the vulnerability of the other, the one which I experience from the other, but also my own vulnerability brings me out of an egocentric perspective. I am already with the other. Now, in the next, this is basically the structure of my talk. So very simple, we will talk about rights, not so much, language, body, and relations. So quite straightforward. To be harmed because of and by rights. This I want to introduce to you very briefly only. I said already, well, one can be violated, rights can be violated, and here I want to say usually rights are there for protection, for freedom or participation. So rights are supposed to protect human beings. But at the same time, also rights can harm people, or laws can harm people if they are unjust, or if they contradict basic human rights. Think about rights which might protect the family at the same time can discriminate certain groups of people who are not living in families of heterosexuality. Then we have the order of law can harm certain groups if it's unjust. So actually rights can protect, but can also harm people. And last not least, one should say, and here I like to refer to Hannah Arendt, there might be one human right. That is the right to have rights. And this will be important later on by referring to refugees. Refugees, people without paper, often have no rights. So therefore, the idea that within a country, within a nation, everybody should have rights, leaves these people more vulnerable who do not have rights. We come to the next one. We are linguistic beings. Earlier when I introduced to you, well, this kind of dualism wouldn't work, then I want now to introduce every human being is actually a linguistic being. We require language in order to be. And it is our vulnerability to language as a consequence of our being constituted within its terms. How can we understand that? This is actually a phrase, or this question, with this rhetoric question, is found Judith Butler's excitable speech. I would think it would be possible, but very hard for me, to insult you. But I think being in an academic context, most of you will hold deeply to your intelligence. So I would think I'm a stranger to you. I will not be very good in insulting you. But if I would single out one person here in this group, this person possibly will turn red, at least a little bit. And if I would say something nasty about the stupidity of the mind, you wouldn't feel good. Why? Because out of your linguistic context, your condition of being used to be clever and smart, you are conditioned already to be vulnerable to certain kinds of insults. This is an example, but not others. There are certainly insults which might leave you totally ambivalent. It doesn't matter. You don't even hear it. But Judith Butler refers to racist speech. So, of course, to call a black person nigger has a tradition. There is a sensitivity to it. To call you nigger, you would just shrug your shoulder and say, no, not part of my business. So the reason why I'm saying this, it's the injurious speech, such as racist expression, hits like a slap in the face and hurts immediately, if it hits. So here you see already, language can reach, or it doesn't, but when it reaches, then you can feel it bodily as well. It's not just like information and some kind of neutral tool. However, there are differences between a linguistic and a physical injury. So I'm not saying that these are just the same. Now we might have to look a little bit, why is it actually that language can harm or hurt? What is it about language? And to do this, I would like to refer to John Austin, a British philosopher, yeah, who talked about or founded the theory of speech acts. There are different levels of speech acts, and I don't want to introduce to you all of them, but I would like to distinguish the elocutionary acts. So that is a performance of a linguistic utterance with elocutionary force and intended social significance, so such as a question or thanking. When I began, I thanked you. By saying this, I am already doing something. So when I promise, I can. I'm doing at the same time also the act of promising, say, give you something back which you borrowed to me. The perlocutionary act is a little bit different. It aims rather at a certain effect of a saying. So convincing someone, enlightening, inspiring, or otherwise getting someone to do or realize something, whether intended or not, doing something by saying something. Now, why is this important? For instance, when you say to somebody, you are ugly, a speaker would perform then a perlocutionary act of insulting the addressee, the listening by way of giving a description, but it's not a harmless description. Or even worse, you might say, when did you shower the last time? The implication is pretty clear. This is not just a neutral question. The effect is, you imply there's this smell. So that is, language in its different forms can be used to support or to attack. Now, since I'm talking about vulnerability, and often vulnerability is seen being vulnerable to bad things, I'm a little bit focusing on the bad things, but later on we have to talk about also the good things. Now, another last example I want to give you about language. Language is also used on the basis of relations. When you say to somebody, you're son of the bitch, I'm not even sure whether I'm allowed to say this here in Oxford, but the son of the bitch hurts the one and insults the other. So this is great. You have already two. You have two people being insulted and the relation. Now, the problems, and I want to simply make you aware of that. Who defines language that hurts sexist, racist speech? Who does it, actually? So what I'm trying to say here, it's not just the individual who invents a certain line of insult or whatever it is, but it is actually a whole language practice which can be corrected also by doing, can be transformed, but not within one day, of course. But the who is in the sense some anonymous. There's not just one person doing this. When does it emerge would be a question for the practice. And I would want to say, who is the subject of the speech act and the action? So perhaps the subject, the person who utters a certain line, might not really be the subject insofar as certain language had been installed in institutions. When you say in the inquiry, when did you shower the last time, might be just perfectly easy, just you want to know, working within a caring situation, but the person you are referring to has a different idea with that. So in other words, the subject of the speech is not just the individual, it's always embedded already in a certain social practice, in institutional practice, but also in different practices, because you don't know whether the person you are talking to will maybe take it in a completely non-informative way. And why does it hurt? Perhaps I leave this to your imagination, basically. So let's see, so I made the point already that language is also felt bodily. And in my next step, I would like to talk about the body. And before I really talk about the body, I would like to introduce you to the author Merleau-Ponty, the French phenomenologist Maurice Merleau-Ponty, who, and some people might also remember Plessner at this point, but I want to do this with Merleau-Ponty. There is a difference between the core, the body, the physical body, and the lived body. And I already referred to it by reference to the history, but I would like to make it stronger. If somebody will cut my finger, or I cut myself, then I'm certainly able to objectify my finger and will say, oh, my body, my finger had been cut, and it hurts. By doing so, I objectify the lived experience and distance myself and can show you the blood dripping out of my finger. The other senses, when I say my body is injured, I'm my body, I feel pain, I'm injured, then I'm not objectifying the pain or the finger, but I'm the one feeling pain because I'm embedded in my body and I'm living bodily. It's, one could say, I live through my body in the world. I am anchored by my body in the world. And so therefore, from the subjective lived experience, it wouldn't make sense to just say, my body is injured, like it would be a thing. It always goes together with lived experience. And because I'm interested in how this life and how this lived experience is protected, I want to one more time refer to Judith Butler, but to her book Frames of War, When is Life Grievable, where she distinguishes between people or lives which are protected and hurt, and others who are simply not, who are neglected. How I am encountered and how I am sustained depends fundamentally on the social and political networks in which this body lives. How I am regarded and treated, and how that regard and treatment facilitates this life or fails to make it livable. So you see, in this sense, by having said already, our body is part of the world, part of our lives, it is a matter of actually how this world is made. And talking about the world is made, I'm not talking just these objects, certainly, but how the relations in the world are structured and how is it cared for, the social and political networks. Basically, what I have to emphasize now more strongly is not just on the bad side, So far, with my examples of injustice and apparently pain and all this, it seems that I have taken vulnerability just in the sense of being vulnerable to bad things. Illnesses, pain, and all these things we do not like. But I would want to stress that by being subjected to others as bodies and as linguistic beings, the vulnerability has to be taken in a double meaning. Double meaning. It is, first of all, and this is not a hierarchy now, but nevertheless, first of all, a possibility of desire. Desire, begehren. And secondly, a condition of possibility for cruelty, subjection, and repression. How can we understand the first one? A condition of possibility of desire. Well, I explained already that we are linguistic beings, we are bodily beings, and we live in relations, but the relations I will make stronger. Well, by being linguistic beings, we necessarily long for the other. We long, it's a longing for the other, because when you speak, then you want to be listened to. You long for the hearer. And if you're not heard, if your language is not heard, then it might just be noise. As Rancière, the French philosopher, would say, it's just noise. So if you speak and other people will hear noise, you're nobody. So in that sense, your vulnerability is, in terms of language, is one for longing to the other, being open to the other, to want the other. And the same for the body. There's a longing for touch, sex, love, empathy. Which is not bad, huh? But of course, also here one must say empathy, and I just want to give you, this is like a footnote. Empathy has also a certain double meaning, because empathy you want from your lover, but also the torturer must be empathetic, must have empathy, I guess I say. So in that sense, certain notions, then they are not just good or bad, but they have often this kind of double side to it. And the other side, because we are vulnerable to others, we are open to cruelty, to subjection, to repression, to violence, whatsoever. And it seems to me that this is very important, and at this part of my lecture, I actually want to share with you a poem which is written by one of the prisoners in Guantanamo, and it seems to show why, what does it mean, this longing? My rib is broken, and I can find no one to heal me. My body is frail, and I can see no relief ahead. The tears of someone else's longing are affecting me. My chest cannot take the vastness of emotion. Who is longing? The tears seem not to be his own, at least not exclusively his own. The emotions are everywhere and nowhere. Words were passed around on cups or little pieces of paper in Guantanamo. Words are smuggled outside of the camp into the world. The poem might not change the politics, but they leave traces. Traces that hand over the body's longing for another and the body being repressed by the other. So it seems we have to talk about psychic injury and violence. So it is to take this a step further with this very interesting author, Alain Scarry. physical and psychic injury and violence, they come together, and violence can destroy language. Physical pain does not simply resist language, but actively destroys it, bringing about an immediate reversion to a state anterior to language, to the sounds and cries a human being makes before language learned. So what we can say that pain is actually a physical experience of negation, conflating the private and public, self-exposure without sharing, solitude, world-destroying. And as Alain Scarry would say, that the first slap, the first knock of the torturer was the worst, because then the world disappears. Then the world seemed to collapse. So here we have an example of difficulty also to talk by being having pain or after the pain, even if the physical wounds are healed, their signs and injuries can remain. So that is what we learn here, that in a certain sense, caring cannot simply be done on the basis of narration, or just tell me how you feel. It doesn't work. It might be working sometimes, sometimes not. So this kind of, this part of the authors or this discourse I introduced here is implying that physical violence, psychic destruction, world destruction, cannot be simply transformed into narration and speaking about it. But on the other hand, so also here, it is not one-sided. I have another example where you have simply the opposite. This book, The Wounded Storyteller, by Arthur Frank, describes how illness can be the condition for a relation. So there you have, beside, in a sense, the opposite of what I was just telling about. So the person he describes is Judith. So Judith's distinctiveness as a storyteller is her illness. Illness was not just the topic of her story. It was a condition of her telling the story. It was about leukemia. Her story was not just about illness, the story was told through a wounded body. So that means we have here an idea that illness is taken as also world-destroying, as it is written, as a loss of destination and map. Yeah. So that might be similar. But then people feel a need for an own voice, not just medical perspective, but because I don't want to be seen just as medical patients, but an own voice in order to refine destination and map. There are some authors like Rilke or the German Sloterdijk tell your life, with implying that by narration you can find your, refind your identity and your path in life. But as I say, it is not necessarily so. So in terms of pain, it seems we have both sides. We have destroying of language, making narration presumably impossible, or perhaps later possible, I don't know, but really a destroying of language involved. But on the other side, taking pain and illness as a condition of narration. I find this interesting, and it is not clear. When you meet somebody in a care situation, you will not know. So how to do here? I'm a philosopher, I pose questions. So let's see. Now we should talk about actually social and generative relations. Now, social relations I take to be those with others. Generative relations are rather the ones referring to where someone comes from. So it is more in this kind of vertical fence, who is from whom is one born. I'm born from my mother, and my mother is born from her mother. And in that sense, generative refers to the line of generations. And what I want to press, and I guess now it's time to look at it more closely, and I have basically sort of said it already, life has sense according to the experiences in relations. Experiences of the sense of life are always and necessarily made in the realm of social and generative relations. So when you think about when were you happy, when were you sad, when were you ashamed, if you think about these experiences, then you think about situations of relations. And sometimes people ask me, well, must it be a human relation? Well, mostly it is, but I can also see here sometimes one can be also very happy because you have a wonderful sight on the ocean or to things. So that's possible as well, but I would think important here is experiences in relation, and this I take to be a fundamental a priori, so it is always already made before your experience, it is clear. Now, the underlying thesis underneath my talk here is really that experiences are bodily embedded and they are made within relations with oneself, with others, with the world. And when you think then about care can change experience of the meaning of life by caring for good relations. So if you think in this way, it seems that the web of relations and actions have a normative status. It's not simply neutral or indifferent in which relations we live. Children go up, the elderly live, whoever needs the care for. So that means care is not, I take care to be not just for one individual, but it is always also a care for the relation with this individual, but perhaps also the individual's relations with others. Now, you see, it's always the same structure, being vulnerable because of and by relation. And by showing this, I would like to discuss this last part concerning trust. Who is responsible? And then about contingency of vulnerability. But first, I have to address trust. Because it seems to me, trust and mistrust is very important for good relations in a caring situation. It would not make sense, for instance, to trust only in regard one person. And so there is also a trustful atmosphere, perhaps. But when we think about the relation first, then I would like to refer to Annette Bayer, who formulated trust is accepted vulnerability to another power. Thus, someone is more vulnerable to a particular person in a trust situation. But at the same time, remember my friend in the beginning, to make oneself vulnerable to the other might strengthen the relationship. Let's see, what does trust mean? Almost everybody has it, but without noticing it. And this holds, I think, for adults and children. It is self-evident, and only the loss will give notice of that which had been. As the moral philosopher Annette Beyer says, we live in an atmosphere of trust. We perceive it like air, namely, not until its supply is short or dirty. The comparison shows trust is, I think, indispensable, the subtly, and the transgressing. And I want to shortly make sense out of these three points in order to then show why actually vulnerability is because and by relations. Now, indispensable, it seems the clearest one, is there in order to feel well and secure. And it is indispensable also regarding future activities. If we would live in total security, presumably we wouldn't need trust. So in that sense, trust compensates potential insecurities and vulnerabilities. Secondly, trust is subtly, if it is. If things are well, just normal, then it seems just habitual, then it seems nobody really talks about it. Then trust is simply there. And this habitual trust is very basic and is taken from very early on. It is a form of trust which does not ground on proofs, but rather the lack of proofs. As Diego Gametta, a sociologist, was saying, in other words, distrust is based on proofs and good reason. Trust rather happens and involuntarily. You cannot simply decide, now I go and trust. That's impossible. And certainly, trust is transgressing because it is placed on different forms, first of all, and because it contains what I call a belief surplus. So trust is transgressing because it has different forms which transgress the individual and which cannot be determined by a system. So it cannot be, I mean, this kind of trust, making trust by certain programs seems to be very difficult, perhaps impossible. Individual dimension of giving trust to someone without necessarily receiving trust, but by taking somebody trustworthy. So that's one, that's often one sort of central relation of trust, and examples are often parent-child relation, also care relations. Then secondly, why trust is transgressing, the trusting person feels to be in an atmosphere of trust, or in a climate of trust, as O'Neill would say. So here, a whole family, a care team, a medical team, they already, when you work into buildings, institutional buildings, you might feel awkward, or you say, okay, fine, things are fine. So it's mostly more than just one individual has or has not. And this atmosphere or climate of trust depends upon an ethos of trust, and is bound into a general institutional room of trust. Now, trust is transgressing because of a belief surplus. I think this is a very important point. Trust is more as that which can be spoken about or rationally expressed. Trust seems to be more than having good reasons or rational criteria. Usually, we play trust in between blind trust or trust as being simply familiar with someone. Philosophical approaches of trust all show that trust is more than the belief to be able to rely on someone. Trusting someone goes beyond or merely relying on someone. Why? Because when we are let down by someone or something we rely on, we are disappointed. But when we are let down by someone we trusted, we are and mostly feel betrayed. Distrust, hence, is not merely a lack of trust. Distrust is a phenomena on its own. Distrusting someone goes beyond merely not relying on his or her, and it doesn't need to be accompanied or by expectation of such specific kinds. I might mistrust somebody without necessarily expecting him or her of taking my interest into account or having goodwill. To put it brief, if we misplace non-reliance, we maybe miss an opportunity. But if we misplace distrust in someone we could have trusted, that is, who is trustworthy, then we have wronged that person and we have reason for an apology. So distrust, therefore, means to have reasons, is always specific and selective, as O'Neill would say, to feel betrayed or have the opportunity to feel betrayed is different from disappointment simply. To feel more vulnerable and insecure concerning the surrounding world or other people. Thus, distrust is transgressing the individual herself, but it is secondary insofar as trust had been expected, broken, or betrayed. So I think trust is actually primary. And now I would want to sort of summarize these last points because it seems easier for you and they're of some importance. The person who trusts someone can be strongly disappointed or hurt by that person. Nevertheless, she feels stronger and more secure. So hence, I would like to distinguish positive or good relations and bad or negative relations. For instance, trust relation between two people, X and Y, one usually fits in there, makes the one person stronger, but certainly it can be hurt, and this more deeply. Out of a bad relation, so for instance, mistrust, X is more secure and vulnerable to the other, and for X, it can come worse, in a sense. I mean, that's the expectation. Unless X was wrong, and then there is perhaps reason for apology. Sorry. Thus, I hold that care praxis should not just focus on individual needs and capacities of a person, but care for this good relations. So I come to the second point, responsibility. Who is responsible for the vulnerability of the other? One answer is that, which you find in the literature, that the one who has the most power over the dependency of the other has the most responsibility. So the ideal picture is here, parents are the most responsible for their children because children depend on their parents. I think, of course, why not? One can do this. But I don't think this is a good picture, actually. First of all, I disagree here with the picture of dependency. I would rather take it as I did before with vulnerability. I would take it as it has also two sides to it. Dependency can also be connotated positively of having stability. So in that sense, to always think dependency in terms of lack of autonomy, as it is usually done, is not necessarily. Of course, there are certain dependent relations, which I have at least in my family, and I'm very happy about it. And this is not the question whether I'm happy about it, but the point is that dependent relations can install stability only when they are harmed, then of course, and there we come back, the point about trust I made, person feels betrayed or hurt or whatsoever. And secondly, I disagree with this picture of who has a power about somebody should care the most. So this idea of dependency, because there are, so I disagree about the general idea, because there are quite a few people who do not live in dependency relations. And so they do this idol of parent-child is not valid because they are certain, for certain people, because they are not even having specific dependency relations. So take, for instance, and I referred to this example earlier, take, for instance, refugees. I mean, they would like to have certain dependency relations, specific dependency relations, but often nobody seems juridically, socially responsible. They don't have a language. And so in that sense, one must create a relation. And here, it seems to me with certain groups, this idea of starting with dependency relation and then saying, okay, here you must care the most, will not work with groups who do not have these specific dependency relations, only in certain anonymous way that they're of course dependent on the goodwill of institutions. But formally speaking, they are nobody. Now, to the now I like to turn to the third approach in concerning relations, and we ask about the status of vulnerability in a more specific way. I think we understood already, or I hope that I made clear for you, that vulnerability is not a fixed characteristic of a person. I mean, that should be clear by now. And I said also there is an ontological general sense of vulnerability. It is always part of the human condition. Now, I would want to or have to talk about specific vulnerability, which emerges more or less on the basis of the context, because, and here I bring in my what I've spoken about, different rights, language, and body practices, and because of different relations and circumstances. Certainly, most people are vulnerable in certain time, in certain places, or certain contexts. Someone, for instance, with physical disabilities can be more or less vulnerable to dangers and harms in the environment, depending on the technical aid and infrastructure. What is normal furniture? If I would have been smaller and shorter, you wouldn't have seen me here. I'm pretty much normal sight, that's okay. But so what I want to say, what is taken as normal is, and what is taken as anormal, and hence needing extra care and extra treatment, depends upon the structure and build-up of the environment. As Jackie Lee Scully says, the distinction normal and anormal is a political decision. What do you install where? So in a sense, there might be some inherent vulnerabilities. Certainly with somebody, for instance, might have problems with the equilibrium, so with might be deaf. But how much that matters, these problems, are actually contingent factors. So in that sense, there is a contingent vulnerability. And I take contingent to mean could be otherwise, First of all, and secondly, it's not arbitrary. So it's not anything goes, but certainly some things could be otherwise. Now, Jackie Litscarly might say, well, if some of the abnormal circumstances were transformed into normal, then certain people would not be regarded as being so not poor in terms of money, so needy and in their life, and perhaps they would need less care and treatment. But if the anormal person got excluded from the normal system of social relations, rights, language, and body practices, then she might be also treated as not needing care. Thus, questions about the relation between vulnerability and care should be posed in the context of rights, language, body practices, and social and generative relations. So in that sense, if I may refer to my friend will not betray me. And I, my friend, so I take the plural actually here. And I love them and need them. And because of my vulnerability, which I show to them, she or he will not hurt me. But in case they do, a world may be scattered, and perhaps they were not friends in the first place. So my friends, perhaps they are no friends. Letting oneself to be vulnerable to the other can be a particular strength responding to the vulnerability, inherent and contingent, is central to care relations, but also to political engagement. Thank you.
I'd be most happy to guide you through our questions or debate, and welcome any questions, remarks, maybe clarifications that you would need. The floor is yours. Many. I begin at the last.
Thank you very much. A question for clarification, if I may. I might have missed the first few minutes of what you were saying, but in this analysis of vulnerability, would it be fair to say that you're also attempting to give something like a typology of the types of harm to which humans are subject? So you're meant to cover all types of harm? I mean, is that what you were trying to do? Or mm-hmm. you're just picking out some things of interest, or?
Mm-hmm. Thank you for this question. I hope to pick out perhaps the most central, but I'm certainly not, I cannot cover all of them. So that's for sure. But my point is to say that vulnerability is always because of our condition in respect to body language relations and rights also, and it can be all harmed by these at least four. I can see that there may be more, of course, but in terms of, I have to begin. So vulnerability has always a sense of a condition of being harmed, but also of not being harmed, of being more secure, because of the sensitivity one shows to the other. So in that sense, harm is a very large field, and I'm sure there are more ways of harming somebody. And I have not. I don't know. I didn't really want to. I didn't think about do I have all of them. But I tried to give you the examples to clarify the notion of vulnerability. So,
yes, of course.
Yeah. I would understand vulnerability as vulnerability to harm.
Yeah, and my point is that this is only one side of vulnerability. Vulnerability has two poles. Being open to the vulnerability of the other, to the sensitivity, and if I show myself vulnerable in, to somebody else, then it might also be a basis for care. This is the point which I started off with Levinas. It seems to me that in a trustful relation, you do not live, I mean, now I'm very strong to make the point. You cannot live in a trustful situation if you do not show your vulnerability, that you are actually can be beaten by the other, but you know you will not. And this, I think this is often overseen, this side. I'm not saying this is the most important, but I think there's an ambivalence between the two, but these two poles of vulnerability exist, and mostly, you're right, in most discussions, people say, oh, what is somebody vulnerable to? And then comes harm and illness and all these things, but I'm offering a picture which seemed to be more full sketched, and where I would argue for that vulnerability is not just being vulnerable to bad things.
Thank you very much. I'm still thinking of so many things in this talk, but one thing I want to ask is the connection between vulnerability and also to an extent dependence, that they're different things, and status or power. Because it seems to me that the connotations of vulnerability and the connotations of dependence are to do with being on the wrong side of a power relation, to be under somebody's power. But yet that doesn't... in terms of one person supplying another person's need, that isn't the case at all. So someone who has servants, mm-hmm. who has slaves, who is a king, he may not be able to boil an egg, but someone boils his egg for him. Mm-hmm. He is dependent, but he has high status. Mm-hmm. But when we talk about a vulnerability or dependence, we think of it in terms of low status. We don't think of in terms of the high status. You know, I can't drive, but I have a chauffeur. But if I'm driven around not by a chauffeur, but in an ambulance by social services.
What was the last one? Excuse me, the last sentence. If you are not driven by.
Well, a chauffeur. I have a driver.
Yes.
Sorry.
Yeah, yeah.
Then I have high status. But if I'm driven by social services because I can't drive, then this is to do with my dependence and low status. And in both cases, I can't. So I'm wondering about the connotations of the word vulnerability and also dependence in relation to these power relations.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for your question. Yeah, the first part of your question referred actually to the Hegelian idea of recognition, that of course the master-slave relation of dependency, and if the one dies, actually the power of the other one dies as well. And In that sense, there is a very obscure dependency, and I was not really thinking about this one. One could, of course, phrase dependency in that terms, but I think one must not do it in terms of recognition. Here, I was thinking rather in a very, very concrete sense that the one who is dependent of somebody else will, by this dependency, install or might install a certain superiority of the other. Yeah, this is how one could think it. And then the question arises, and this I will not repeat, what sort of responsibility results out of it. You were rather asking, and I think this is a very interesting question, but would have to, well, sort of another paper. We have a social structure and asymmetrical relations in society, and how do we deal with them? And certainly, I'm immediately agreeing that someone who is of low status and poor and so on and so forth is more vulnerable, say, for floods and winds and exploitation and so on and so forth. Yes, certainly. When you look at the care situation, and if the care situation or care practices are installed within a hierarchical society, then of course the hierarchy of the society needs to be addressed in very different terms, and these were the references to look at the political network, look at the political, how is it done, and so forth. But if you look at on the more base level, you might say, then it seems it's a living, it's a notion of dependency which is perhaps more creative, but can lead also to the two sides and not necessarily to these problems. Yeah, you want more, huh? You look like you.
When you said that the person who supplies the need is in the superior position, I think if I go to a restaurant and I pay for a meal, because I pay, I'm in the superior position. They supply my need. Yeah. I don't cook, they cook.
But they are
supplying the need, I am receiving the need, but that doesn't mean to say that they have power over me. They have power over me because they can produce a bad meal and I suffer from the bad meal. So they have power, but in some way. But then I can go to another restaurant and I can get somebody else's service. So just because someone supplies my need, it doesn't necessarily mean...
Just because someone supplies my need,
it doesn't mean to say that they have power. In a way, they have power over me, but not necessarily. And it seems that the words of vulnerability and dependence, we think of the supplier of the need as always as being the higher, and the person with the need as being the lower. But in many cases,
yes, I see what you mean.
If we're customers,
yeah, you are the customer situation. Yeah, here in my talk, I did not address the customer situation. So yeah, you are right. One could, of course, do that, and one would have a very different picture, perhaps. But I'm not sure in what sense you then measure the vulnerability. I mean, does it really give us a clue then what vulnerability would mean if you very too quickly perhaps transfer it in monetary measurements? That in the end, I am the filthy rich customer, and and therefore I have the power. And I wouldn't be sure. I mean, I think it's interesting, and of course it gives a picture of society and how we can deal with needs. It's within a frame of a certain liberal society, and we might then reduce the person also to their status and monetary possibilities. You know, if you immediately transfer it, and that would be then the problem we said. But yeah, I mean, one could of course make sort of include it and enlarge it on this point. Thank you.
You asked for the microphone, didn't you?
Yes, do you have a definition of empathy? You use the word. I wondered what you meant by it and how that relates to the possibility of being damaged.
Mm-hmm. Empathy, Einfühlung in German. I say this because I know that you know German. Empathy, being able to perceive or to think from the side of the other one, to feel with the feeling of the other one. Yeah. So it is not just regarding the feeling, but And it's not just feeling the same as the other one. I mean, like with certain pains or certain feelings, it's impossible. But it is empathetic, so feeling oneself into the other one. And I think this is extremely important in relations and in all sorts of relations. But this kind of empathy or feeling from the side of the other can be misused also like in interrogations, in the mix of physical pain, physical violence, and interrelations, say in torture situations, to know when do I put the next slap.
Are you describing a first person perspective there, or a third person sort of objective thing? And how do you distinguish from compassion or sympathy?
This phenomenological perspective is neither just the first person nor it is just the third person. It is trying to make sense of the feeling of the other by respecting the otherness of the other. So it's not just being first-person perspective, but it's perhaps alike. Compassion is more feeling with. Mm. Feeling with the other, which is another notion, could also be entered in here, but I think a torturer should not be compassionate with the victim, should not feel worse. Yeah.
Jason.
Thank you. Thank you, I really enjoyed the talk and thought it was wonderful the way that you elaborated on vulnerability. But what I think I was hearing was that you're talking about vulnerability as a sort of a precondition to ethical action or something like this. And I'm wondering what you think about where does the ethical then come from? Where now that we're vulnerable to both pain and to both caring in a deep relationship in that way, what determines or what matters then for how we then act one way or the other? I've seen vulnerable people in both ways either act in violence or in great care. So I'm wondering, where does the ethical come in for the person in that experiencing vulnerability? How does the context matter?
The vulnerability or this openness, because of the vulnerability, will not necessitate an ethical action. So I would not claim this, but it gives a ground for the possibility. So it is a condition of the possibility of ethical action. So if you if you hear the other in his or her vulnerability and Levinas. I mean, you're asking about Levinas, basically. Like he would say, silent cry. So it's not help me. So it's not like we would say this, but you have the possibility to respond to it. So in that sense, the possibility to respond is primary to do I help or not. And if you don't help, which you can do, I mean, there's no philosophical or structural theoretical problem, you turn around and say, no, I don't do it. So in that sense, it's not possible to make somebody ethical. But the point is, if you turn around, it is already an ethical decision, I'm not going to help. So in that sense, it's not primary, what shall I do? Kant, but it's rather you are already drawn into the situation, drawn towards the other, and then you follow with or without reasons, or good or bad, or clever or stupid. So it's not, you know, what you actually do can be totally besides the point because you are not very good in this. But anyway, you're driven by the other's vulnerability. Oh, and then this is in the second stance, you voluntarily say, no, distance, I'm not going to help you or whatever.
And do you see that as a bodily reaction?
I see that not just as a bodily reaction, but as a reaction by a bodily embedded human being bodily embedded then in language, in relations, in the world, in the customs. I mean, there are also certain things which I find always important. There are things we don't see. We could see, but we don't see. Because we are embedded in certain habits and so habituated seeing also. And so in that sense, it's not just the bodily being embedded, but a being habituated. So habituated is living like in a house within certain customs and rules. And this is primary. And then this turning around would be then the secondary move.
I'm looking at Jakob because I don't have a watch with me.
We still have around 10 minutes.
Okay. Anybody else? If you allow me, Christina, I would like to pursue the question of Jason. There is care that adds harm.
Mm-hmm.
Not by intention, I mean bad people, bad intentions,
mm-hmm.
but care that adds harm to someone already very vulnerable. And I wonder if your line of thought could clarify this particular situation where, for instance, in hospitals where patients are treated in a very professional and very responsible way, and yet the cure is prolonged too long.
Mm-hmm.
People go on the famous tenacity of the physician, or the system of care is pursued, and while people in the surroundings of the patient ask themselves, why are they going on? It's so obvious that this doesn't bring any good anymore, and yet people do continue to give this particular very professional and also very professional kind of care. So could you say something about that kind of vulnerability that is, so to say, created
mm-hmm.
by care.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not talking about bad intentions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Part of this question I addressed, but certainly too briefly, in reference to people with disabilities, and my last point, making the difference between inherent and contingent vulnerability. And contingent vulnerability, so that is a vulnerability that is rather inflicted by the environment or by other people or the infrastructure, is the one you are asking about. That certainly by a system, say concrete hospital routinization and automatism and bureaucracy, vulnerability can be, so now vulnerability in the sense to bad things, yeah, to more illness, to more harm, can be increased, but we have to understand here that this is then not an inherent vulnerability. And even so, of course, it is inherently felt by the person. I mean, the person suffers, But yet, how it is brought about is by the external system. So in that sense, I would not say, or one of the points, I guess, what I wanted to say is that harming is never, is not necessarily by intention. None of these examples I have given, also already talking my little things about insults, could be with intention, but can be also without intention.
Yeah, exactly. That's
the thing. Now, when you ask me, well, how do you distinguish? Of course, that is a whole discourse about what is normal, what is a language system, what is anormal, what is a routine. So in my offer here is, and I think then perhaps sociologists or others have to go on, look also at the social and political side of the institution, but not only on the apparent need and of one particular person, and then how we can restructure hospital routine. Then of course I would say, well, I can look at it closely, but I think as a philosopher I would rather ask these nasty questions. And here, and I think this is your question is a good example where then also philosophy and political scientists and social scientists, and actually then people really working in the hospital and knowing about the situation have to work together in sorting out what is actually due to the normality of the system, but as you say, hurting, what is due to bad attention, what is due to simple stupidity, practical issues, and what is due to the kind of infrastructure somebody is in. So, and there is a constant. Historically looking at it, I'm in a sense a bit relaxed about it because we constantly reevaluate also our ways of thinking about these issues. I mean, starting with Plato, huh? But there is a constant reevaluation, and this is needed here.
Okay, thank you. I think we have completed our round. Jacob, maybe you're.
Thank you very much. So please join me to thank Christina for a really interesting lecture.
Thank you. So,
and then I especially want to invite you to our next presentation, the last one. Over the past 7 weeks, we heard all kinds of fascinating conceptual considerations around the ethics of care. And in this last presentation by Andries Baart, we will look at some methodological considerations based on what we heard over the past 7 weeks. So please, we'll see you next week. Thank you.